Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So what is anointing? Anointing is God's supernatural ability added to your natural ability, giving us supernatural ability to succeed in any challenge we face in our life. I repeat again, it is God's supernatural ability added to our natural ability, giving us supernatural ability, giving us supernatural ability to succeed in any challenge we face. This morning in the ninth vigil we learned how, what is the formula of success?
Preparation plus opportunity plus test is equal to success.
Now somebody will say, brother, how do you back it up with a scripture? Can I back it up with a scripture?
Yes.
About success?
Yes.
Anybody knows? You'll say, oh, this one, I know it. Joshua 1:8. Joshua 1:8 says, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. Means what? Your mouth will be loaded with the scriptures, with God's instructions, God's ways. You shall meditate thereon day and night. 2, 3, with what you have prepared, you will put it into practice and pass the test by observing to do according to all that is written therein. For if you do these three things, preparation, opportunity to pass the test by doing what the word of God says, then he says, you shall make your way prosperous. Not God. You shall make your way prosperous and you shall have good success. So the more and more you meditate on the word of God, the more and more you will experience the anointing of the Holy Spirit giving you the strength to obey the word of God, and that obedience will lead you on the way. And that's why it says, the word of God says, you shall make your way prosperous. It's not God, but following the instructions of God will make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. Praise God.
Praise God.
So this ability of God gets rubbed on us the more we meditate on God's word, the more we speak God's word. And when we do these two things, we will receive the power of God, the ability of God to put it into practice. Praise God.
Amen.
So one thing is sure in each one's life, that henceforth and in the future, we are going to face great challenges, great battles in our life. And I want to tell you, the greatest miracle or the greatest blessing in your life is in the midst of challenges. For example, during the time of David, okay, David faced Goliath. Nobody knew David. But it was David when he used the anointing of God, okay, and killed Goliath. What happened? David got promoted to the highest position and everybody in the kingdom came to know Goliath. So what is the Lord teaching us? The anointing is given to us to get results, to get victories in our life. Praise God. So in other words, the size of your challenges, the size of your enemy is the size of your reward. So smaller the challenges, smaller the reward. And that's what happens in our life. The moment we face challenges, we get into depression. But actually speaking, you should get excited that now that you are anointed and using God's ways and God's tools, you will turn it around into victory. And it will bring forth great reward. So great blessings are hidden in troubled waters. But how many of us want to jump into the troubled water? The Bible says the angel of the Lord came and troubled the water. And the first one who got into that troubled water was healed. You remember?
Yes.
So if you are in the midst of some troubled water, praise God, there's news for you. God has anointed you to get victory in that troubled water, but you got to be extremely vigilant to follow the instructions given in the Bible and praise be to God, you will come out of the troubled water not only victorious, but much more than that, you will come back with a new change in your thinking, change in your nature, change in your character, change in your lifestyle. Has it happened in your life? When you face challenges, God not only gave you victory over those challenges, but much more than those victories, you found that your lifestyle changed. No?
Yes. Not so often.
What challenges?
Challenges are there, but you do not win them according to the word of God.
Yeah, because it's a process, no? But before the victory can come, there has to be change in your lifestyle. Because if you are going to follow God's instructions, then it will surely be a change from the worldly lifestyle to godly lifestyle. Praise God. So, here is God giving us an assurance that there is an empowerment available to us that will help us win every battle we face. And St. Paul gives us an example. He gives an example to Timothy. Now, Timothy was a young fellow and he was looking after a church. And the elders over there were coming against him. And Timothy was getting into depression. And that's the time Paul gave him instruction, 1 Timothy 6:12. Let's start with 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil. For the love of money is the root of all evil. So is money evil?
No.
So what is evil?
Love of money.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because whatever you are in love with, you give that the highest priority, the highest position, in life. Praise God. You are all the time thinking about it. You are all the time dreaming about it. Praise God. So craving for money, greed for money is evil. Money is not evil. And if you think money is evil, you can transfer the amount in my account. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Praise.
Which while some coveted after, they had erred from faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So even though they received Jesus, they received the power of God, they were operating in faith, but the craving for money got them on the wrong side and they found themselves now with many sorrows. But you, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience and meekness. So the first thing you got to follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience and meekness. Fight. Say that.
Fight.
Now he did not stop there. Many Christians only read the first word.
Fight the good fight.
No, they don't read the whole sentence. They read only the first word
fight.
And they stop there. And they say it's given in the Bible. Fight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So they follow 1 Timothy 6:12 only the first word. Not the whole sentence. So he said, fight the good fight of faith. Now the good fight of faith means fight the evidence that is negative, contradicting to God's word, fight against it with the evidence that comes from the word of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, somebody will say, but I'm a peace-loving Christian, I do not like to fight. Listen, whether you are a peace-loving Christian, you got to fight because we got an enemy who is fighting against us. His name is devil. So, every Christian will have to get into a fight, spiritual fights. But most of the time we get into
physical fight.
Praise God. So the Bible says we do not fight against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness. So when there is hurt feelings, offense, snare and all these things, do you fight against that spirit that is causing this, or do you fight against the person on whom the spirit is using that person to bring offense and all these things? Where?
On the person.
So from now on, are we supposed to fight with the person or love that person?
Love that person.
Love that person.
But most of the time, well, what do? We hate the spirit or we hate the person?
We hate the person.
Because we do not understand that it's not the person, it's that spirit operating in that person. So fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on gold and silver and diamond and Louis Vuitton bags.
Huh? Lay hold on eternal life.
I don't know other brands. Lay hold on
eternal life.
And what are we laying hold on?
Material things.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, our focus should be the treasures of heaven and not on the treasures of this earth. Once you got your focus right, praise God, your desires in life will begin to change. Because when desires are not fulfilled, what happens to you?
Your mind is agitated.
Your mind is agitated. Now, if you got a desire, okay, and that desire to fulfill, you are ready to pay any price to fulfill that desire, and that desire might be flesh. Now, you are using God's resources to fulfill that that desire. And we as stewards are supposed to give accounts, because all the resources that God has given us never belongs to us. We are just stewards, and that's why we got to use them in a way that will be pleasing to the master. And once he sees that you are using the resources in a pleasing way, he will give you more resources, because God is looking for genuine distributors on earth. And if you are an excellent distributor of his resources, bringing great productivity and great profits in the kingdom, God will begin to multiply your distributing what? Department or your ministry. Praise God. So fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. Lay hold on eternal life. Whereunto you are also called and has professed a good profession before many witnesses. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So here is God saying to us through the example of Timothy that there is going to be a battle, but we got to fight the good fight of faith. And when we fight the good fight of faith using the scriptures, using the tools of God, praise be to God, it will turn into victory in our life, and we will win many battles. And one of the beautiful testimony that this baby shared about how she had a hurt feeling, a friend had a hurt feeling, they never had good relationship, but when she heard the word of God and she made a decision that I need to ask for forgiveness because I was bitter, even though she was the one who caused that bitterness, but yet I am willing to ask for that forgiveness. When she began to do that, praise God, what was enmity turned into
friendship.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Even that sower and the seed CD which has come, it has come from a person who had made a vow that I will break this preacher's legs if he comes to Busawal. But I did not fight with him, but began to love him. And in that love, his wife got healed and he came to listen to the word of God. And that's where God touched him, changed his life. And he said he could not attend the retreats. So he asked me to record it on a recorder and send it to him. So I would send this cassette to him. And one fine day, after 7-8 months, he came with a CD and he said, I've brought this for you. And I was surprised. And that's how the first CD came, Sower and the Seed, by a person who had taken a vow to break my legs.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. And that CD, I don't know how many lakhs of copies we have made and how many people around the world have got blessed. Praise God. So you are going to face battles, but you are going to use the anointing of God to win these battles. And this anointing will begin to operate in your life if you fight the good fight of faith. Not your senses, but the fight of faith. Yes.
Now, when you're fighting these battles, can I share it with my husband what's happening? See, I won't be telling it to an
outsider. It is also very important. I'll give you another case. In Dubai, there is a husband and a wife who are working in the same company. Okay? So, they would come back home and she would speak what's happening in her department. Okay? And he would be speaking what's happening in his department. And every day the discussion was all about the hurts and all about this thing. So each one is not encouraging each other. Each one is talking about the hurts. And after a few weeks or few months, they went into such a depression and they called up Alred. Thank God. And they said, you know, we are going into depression, we don't understand and all those things. So he said, what are you all discussing? So the husband said, I'm telling my wife what's happening in my department. And he said, when you are saying those things, is your wife saying, let's pray, let's fight this good fight of faith? Or is she saying about her department? He said, she's saying about her department. So you got good fellowship of hurts and wounds, and there's no good fight of faith. So he said, first of all, stop bringing those things at home and discussing with a person who is giving you shoulder to cry. In God's kingdom, you don't give shoulder to cry. You make that person stand and say, come on, use your ammunition, use your weapons and fight the good fight of faith. Don't come to me to take my shoulder and cry on my shoulder. It's time for you to fight.
Yeah, but bringing it home and then praying about it is fine.
Yes, if your husband is encouraging you, building you up, and saying, come on, let's not get into this. Let's fight. Let's pick up the scriptures. Let's do that. Praise God. So what will happen is, you will be encouraged. You will be built up. Now, when he says, yeah, did they do that? Very sorry. You know, next time you should behave this way. Tit for tat. Now, what happened? You came with one problem. He gave you counseling. Not you, brother. He gave you counseling, which was ungodly. You went and got hit again and you came back with more problems because you followed the wrong instruction. So that's what I said, very important is, how do we fight? When we face trials, when we face challenges, we don't sit to give each other shoulder to cry. We find scriptures, how to use and load our ammunition and start firing and fighting the good fight of faith. And operating in love. Very, very important is, no matter what happens, continue to operate in love. Praise God.
Praise God.
Because we have seen so much of opposition, so much of persecution, so much of accusation. So we never went to fight with those people who did that. But we kept on operating in love and continued to do what God had called us. And praise be to God, it all turned into victory.
Praise God.
Do not waste your time, your energy, and your resources in arguments. Fight the good fight of faith in love. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't go into debating. You're wasting your energy and your time. Many a times, you want to convince a person. And if the person has closed his mind and a person is not teachable, a person doesn't want to hear, you're wasting your time, you're wasting your energy, and you'll come back more frustrated. Let the Lord fight your battle. You fight the good fight of faith by believing the scripture. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So just as battles are real, victories are more real. Praise God.
Praise God.
And that's why for you to experience this victory, you all the time need the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And remember, the Holy Spirit will always, always, always speak to you things which are in line with the Word of God. He will never speak or give you any instruction that is contradicting to God's Word. Then it's not the Holy Spirit, it's the evil spirit deceiving you. So remember, none of us can win any of the battles without the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And in the guidance of the Holy Spirit, one thing is sure, that you must follow the instructions from the Word of God. then you are fighting the good fight of faith. Example, love your enemies. Because your faith will not allow you to love your enemies, because at that time, praise God.
Need the guidance of the Holy Spirit to fight the battles.
None of us can win on our own strength.
None of us can win any battles without the guidance of the Holy Spirit. For example,
love your enemies.
Because
We are supposed to love our enemies, but can we do it with our own strength?
No, because even when you say that I want to love this person, your flesh is going to fight back.
Yes.
Your flesh will give you so many thoughts. For example, I was talking to a person. This person got changed 5 years back, listening to the CD. He is working in a very wonderful place. And he has got many a times top performance award in his company. Everything is going on fine. So recently he was accused that he is taking kickbacks because he is the person who selects the product. And the boss said, I know that you are taking commission for every product that is being supplied. And he said no. And the boss got so annoyed, you found it? And the boss got so annoyed, he said, I know. So the boss said, I know that you are taking the kickback. So there was Eid holidays, and he said, after the Eid holidays, I want you to come and report to me. If you say that you are not taking, then I'm going to dismiss you. And if you are saying that I'm taking, I'm going to dismiss you. Because anyway, I'm going to dismiss you. Now this person has been living according to the word of God. And this person said, brother, this is what has happened. And I said to him, brother, always remember, God is the source of our life. He is the one who has given the job. He is the one who protects us. And if you are saying that you have not taken it, praise be to God, the Lord will fight for you. So all those Eid holidays, he had sleepless nights. And he said, brother, it's been now 1 week, I have not slept. So I said, you have not slept because you are all the time thinking about what's going to be the result. Why don't you say, do what God says in Isaiah 46:10. He says, I am the Lord who declares the end from the beginning. So you as a child of God, declare your end from the beginning. Declare your victory. So he said, I don't get sleep. I said, praise God, if you don't get sleep, tell the devil, thank you for not giving me the sleep. And I said, why you don't get sleep? Because you are all the time having those thoughts attacking you. He said, yes. So now you say, devil, thank you for not giving me sleep. I'm going to take the scriptures and pray during that time. And I'll have extra time to pray. So I said, don't get depressed because you did not get sleep. But get excited because you did not get sleep. And use that time to pray. And once he sees that you are praying, you are actually tormenting the devil when you are speaking the scriptures spiritually. So once he sees that you are tormenting the devil spiritually, he will see to it that he will put you to sleep. This morning he sent me a message and he said, brother, I slept and I got up at 2:45 and I remember what you said and I started speaking the scriptures. I went to a supernatural sleep. I got up in the morning fresh and I again started speaking the scriptures and I now realized, if the devil attacks me, I open my mouth and continue to speak the scriptures instead of getting irritated. So he said, my situation has gone worse than before after the holidays and everybody has rejected me. Nobody talks to me. I am like an untouchable. I said, praise God. The Bible says in Exodus 14, 13 and 14, God said to Moses, the Egyptian that you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you and you will watch and see the victory of the Lord. So I said, listen, my friend, the Egyptian is not your boss. The Egyptian is that spirit that is using your boss to irritate you. You call, keep on saying the scripture and we will see that spirit that has been using this boss. When they investigate and they search and search and they do not find anything, they themselves will say, we are sorry for falsely accusing you. And remember, every time you go through false accusation, it is the last stage before supernatural promotion.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. I said, get excited, brother. Even I am praying. Let's pray. Let's get this victory. Praise God.
Praise
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, it's the Holy Spirit who will guide you. It's the Holy Spirit who will teach you. It's the Holy Spirit who will strengthen you in the midst of your challenges and give you the victory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
2 Corinthians chapter 2, 14. Please don't forget the scripture. This scripture will really encourage you in the midst of your challenges. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus and makes manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. So God will lead you into victory, and not sometimes, always. Hallelujah.
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 And how will you do that? Through thanksgiving. Remember, if you are a person who is giving thanks to God in everything, then you are operating in faith. Because the more and more you give thanks, your faith is not shaken up. Your faith begins to get strengthened with thanksgiving. For example, a person is praying for a healing. And he says, Lord, I believe that I am healed by your wounds. Now, every time a thought comes but the symptoms are there, he's saying, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Your word has declared it. I believed it and it is done. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So what does thanksgiving do? Thanksgiving will keep you away from grumbling, complaining, murmuring, getting into doubts, getting into unbelief. Praise God.
Praise God.
So thanksgiving is a powerful weapon, and it's a weapon that expands our capacity to receive from God. So in the midst of battles, thanksgiving is a must. Because the scriptures that you are believing in faith has to be backed up with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving will keep you on the path of operating in faith. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So if you are a person who is all the time using thanksgiving, praise God, the anointing is activated by your thanksgiving. Faith is activated by your thanksgiving. There is no room for fear to enter into you. And now, this anointing gives you a guarantee in Christ that you will always have victory. Praise God. And the burdens will be removed of the devil, and the yoke of the devil will be destroyed because of the anointing. Now, how many times do you find yourself praising and thanking God in the midst of your challenge, when you are really, really beaten up, you are hurt, somebody has deceived you, somebody has caused you pain, and you are praising and thanking God and saying, God, I do not understand what's happening, but I do know that Romans 8:28 says, you work all things together for good. I can't see anything good coming here, but yet your word says that you have a God who is able to do, and you always do good for those who love you, for those whom you have called according to your purpose. Praise God.
Praise God.
So once you know that it is going to turn into good, are you going to give him thanks after the goodness comes or before the goodness comes? People of faith celebrate their victory before the manifestation. When they have proclaimed the word of faith, when they have declared their faith, they have already started celebrating their victory. Praise God.
Praise God.
People of the world will first see the manifestation and then start celebrating. People of faith first celebrate and then they see what they had celebrated has come to pass. Praise God.
Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So what's the meaning of the word anointing? Anointing means to rub. To rub on and rub into. So what is God rubbing into us? His wisdom. So the word of God is the wisdom of God. So God is rubbing inside of us His wisdom. And now that you have got the wisdom will change your thinking. When your thinking has changed, your destination has surely changed. So God is giving us wisdom of His kingdom. The devil wants us to have the wisdom of this world. So the more and more you seek the wisdom of God, the more and more you will begin to understand the wisdom of God and use that wisdom, and that wisdom gives you guarantee of the anointing and the victory. Hallelujah.
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 So is this anointing going to be free? No, it's going to cost you. It's going to cost you where you have to pay. Means how do you pay? Not with money, but you pay with your labor. And what's your labor? By spending time studying the word in prayer, praise, thanksgiving. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I remember when my life got changed, and in my early days, I used to be extremely addicted to TV. At that time, this dish antenna had just come up, and there used to be Star Plus and all those channels, and movies, star movies and all those things. And I was all addicted to these channels. So once I got changed, and you know, I would just sit, and let's say the family is watching our TV program, and I would just sit there. It would not even take 30 seconds that I would hear a voice saying, "Why are you sitting here? Why not we go and sit inside and I will teach you the Bible?" So I would go inside and look into the Bible, and I realized there were two televisions in my house. One, the television like this one, which was giving me the world's vision about me and its plan to destroy me. And the television that I was watching on the bedroom was the Bible, where God was giving me His vision for me and His plans that He had and the purpose that He had for my life. So the more and more I began to look into the television called the Bible, it began to speak about God's vision for me. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And in those days I did not know the future would have been so beautiful. Now, actually speaking, many a times I have to pinch myself to really, really come to my senses to believe that this is not a dream, this is real.
Praise God.
Because, you know, when He brought that Batata Vada, He said, "I'm bringing Vada Pav." I did not even want to preach. Because my whole desire, whenever somebody says Batata Vada Pav, my whole desire starts getting excited, because that was my meal for 8 months. So for me, every time I eat it, I remind myself from where God brought me out. So that Vada Pav talks to me and tells me, look what the Lord has done in your life. Look at His mighty hand picking you out of the pit and making you stand on the pulpit to preach the word of God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. That's why they were coming and saying, "Brother, let's start." I said, "No, I want the first, the Vada Pav." Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's why I did not even wait for anybody. I went to the kitchen, and when you know the storekeeper, praise be to God, you get fast. That's why you should always have influence with the storekeeper. The storekeeper, once you have good influence, you get things quickly. You don't have to stand in a queue. And praise be to God, the Holy Spirit is the storekeeper of the kingdom of God. When you have influence with Him, praise be to God, the transfer takes place very fast.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So be in good terms with the storekeeper. So spend time with God and receive revelation from Him. What is revelation? The secrets. that are hidden. And when you receive this revelation, protect this revelation from being stolen by the enemy. Because the Bible says when God speaks to you, His word, and you are fixed on that, no demon in hell can stop your victory. Because that revelation is the Rhema word, it has got tremendous power, it has got tremendous faith, and it will bring result. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And this revelation comes by your fellowship with the Holy Spirit, spending time with the Holy Spirit, and He will give you instructions what to do. He will give you the secrets of the kingdom of God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So, this anointing is given to you to win battles over your flesh. This anointing is not given to you to carry out the desires of the flesh. The desires of the flesh is your enemy. Yourself is your enemy. You are fighting against them using the anointing of the Holy Spirit. So as we face these battles this year, we must understand we can do
all things.
The impossible. We can do the impossible with the help of the Holy Spirit. Now the first thing, do you believe that God has anointed you to do impossible things?
Yes.
Yes.
If only you believe it, if only you know it, and you know it, and you know it, and you know it, then you can step out in faith. Because many a times in Goa, when we have a session, you know, suddenly the Spirit of God will say, stop, and I'm going to show you my glory, He will say, and say, I'm going to heal all these people who have got lumps on their body. So might be about 30, 35, 40 people are standing who have got lumps in their body, and we start praying. And to my amazement, not all get healed. Out of 40, might be 4 or 5 will come and testify that lumps have disappeared. The others are still standing and they still got lumps. Okay? So what do I do? I call these people who have got healed and I tell them to share their testimony, and those who are standing, I'm saying, as you are listening to the testimony, the lumps will disappear. By the time they share their testimony, we find out of 35, 30 got healed. Lumps disappearing instantly. Impossible things becoming possible with the help of the Holy Spirit. I remember we were in Goa and we had an outreach on the grounds, and there was a crowd of 3,500 plus to 4,000 people. And in that crowd, suddenly the Lord said, I'm going to heal people with tumors. So I told my team members had come from Bangalore, from Bombay, from Mangalore, from different places. Okay? And I told them, go into the crowd, and those who are lifting their hands, I want you to go and stand there and pray. And there was this doctor who had come from Bangalore. She's a gold medalist. And she went to pray over a person who had lifted her hands. Okay? And she asked, how many lumps you got? And this lady said, I don't know. She said, what do you mean, I don't know? And she showed her skin. You know, have you seen some people who have got boils on their skin? Yes, round boils. Okay. So her waist to the legs was covered with that. So the doctor was really depressed because she got a person like that. So you can't even count how many. Are you for understanding? They got multiples of that. So we started to pray, and she had her eyes closed and she was praying sincerely. Suddenly this lady started screaming. And she said, what happened to you? She was just screaming, praising God, shouting on top of her voice with eyes closed. And she went on and on and on. And when she stopped, she asked her what happened. She said, look at my skin. And she made her take her hand and put her hand on her legs. Because even though the clothes are there, you can feel it.
Yes.
It was absolutely plain. Every boil had gone out of her. And this doctor till today remembers, and she says, I have no medical explanation Because the person can never get, even after operation, he, that person can't get that skin which is absolutely normal, smooth. I remember I was in Bahrain. This was my preaching inside the church. And the priest told me when I went to visit him, he said, you can preach in the church provided you do not preach anywhere else and no visiting anybody's home and asking for money. Okay, I said, Father, I give you 100% assurance that there will be no money involved and I will do exactly what you say. So he gave me 3 days to preach, and on the third day I was supposed to take my flight to Kuwait. So I went to meet him because, you know, the time was very less. So I went to meet him before the meeting and I said, Father, I won't be able to say goodbye to you. Thank you very much. And he was sitting both the days from the beginning to the end. Okay, and I was teaching on the topic of faith. And he said to me, listening to the word of God and listening to the testimonies and listening to and seeing the glory of God, I want you to make a collection today and I'm going to announce the people to give cheerfully and I want you to have the money. Because just as Paul went preaching, you're going preaching, you need the money. And I said, I don't need the money, I need the time. If you can give me 15 minutes extra, praise God. Because if I'm going to take a collection, I lose 15 minutes. He said, no, you can preach and take the collection. I said, no, I can't do that, because when the word of God is preached, we don't put money, a hand in our pocket. We listen to the word of God. God is speaking to us and we don't want to get distracted. He said, okay. So there was no collection. 15 minutes he gave me extra. Praise God.
Praise God.
And that 15 minutes I had finished preaching and I said, God, thank you for giving me 15 minutes. And I said, how many of you got glands or tumors or lumps on your body? There were 13 of them. They came outside and I asked each one, and there was one lady whom I asked, how many lumps you got? She said, I don't know the numbers, there are plenty. And I said, okay, so let's start with the one who has got plenty. And we began to pray and she fell on the floor and began to roll, she began to scream, and might be the church, many of them were watching for the first time. And I prayed over every one of them. And when she became silent, I asked her, what happened to the lumps? She said, I can't feel anything on my body. It's all gone. Every one of them who was standing were healed. Praise God. Everybody in the church were excited. The priest was excited. The glory of God was there. And I said, come on, let's worship the Lord. And I asked them all to close their eyes. And when their eyes were closed and they were singing, from the back door I disappeared. So they thought it was a fantastic prayer worship. The preacher disappeared. I went to the airport. Okay. Now when I went to the airport, praise be to God, the devil troubled me so much and he kept saying, if each one of them had to give one denarii, you would have had at least 1700 to 1800 denarii, because the church was packed. And he said, you lost it all. And I said, I did not lose it all. The last 15 minutes, I beat you right on your face and everybody saw how the lumps disappeared using the word of God. People's faith began to multiply.
Hallelujah.
So this conversation was going on and I reached Kuwait, and that evening a person came and said to me, he had a dream, God told him to give me 10 lakhs and he came with a check of 10 lakhs to give it to me.
Praise God.
So which one was better, that I take a collection, or God puts a dream to somebody and he comes with the money? I'll tell you, amazing is our God. When you trust Him, you trust in His anointing, blessings will come chasing you.
Praise God.
So God will do impossible things only when you believe. Now the question is, if I had not believed, can I call people out with the whole church watching you and saying, the lumps will disappear now?
No.
Hello?
No.
If you watch on the YouTube, most of our videos are not when a person got healed. Most of the videos are when a person has not got healed and we call him, use the scriptures, use the faith, use the anointing and get the person healed. It's not the other way around. The person got healed and then he came to testify. No. The person is sick and you teach the people how to use the faith and the anointing, and then they experience the victory. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So to experience this anointing, we must be extremely vigilant that we do not grieve the Holy Spirit. When you start grieving the Holy Spirit, then your heart gets hardened. And when your heart gets hardened, you do not hear the promptings of the Holy Spirit, or you no longer hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. You've got to be extremely sensitive, and that sensitiveness comes when you are in extreme touch in relationship with the Holy Spirit. Praise God.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And that's why God is calling unto all of us to a higher level of holiness. Might be you have made mistakes. God still has got a plan. God still has got ways. And God is calling you to a higher calling of holiness. Can we just close our eyes for a moment and reflect on this? The God who always leads us and causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus. He wants us to be the channel who will carry the sweet fragrance of the gospel, the knowledge of God, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the divine touch of Jesus to those around us. He loves us so much that He wants to anoint us, rub His anointing upon us, rub His wisdom into us, into our mind, so that our mind is renewed, so that He gives you the power to believe. He is the one who loves you. He is the one who cares for you. He is the one who wants to do great and mighty things in your life. Let us now repent for the times when we doubted His love, especially in the midst of challenges, especially in the midst of attacks, that we quickly believe the situations and the circumstances. We believe the words of people and got into unbelief and doubt, got into worry and anxiety. We failed to open our mouth and make the declaration of what God's word says. We quickly spoke our defeat and our failures. Let us make that commitment to the Holy Spirit, to Heavenly Father, that from now on we will spend quality time with Him. Because it is only through understanding that we can draw this water from the well. And remember, the water from the well is for your victory. Let us remember the times that under pressure we were the people who were speaking negative things, speaking the facts and not the truths, many a times complaining, grumbling, murmuring, speaking about our failures and our defeats, not using the weapon that God has given us for victory. Even though the Holy Spirit is longing to give us the victory, we have been continuously grieving and quenching the Holy Spirit. Grieving the Holy Spirit by doing things wrong, quenching the Holy Spirit by, in spite of the opportunity given to us, we fail to take that opportunity to do good and obey His instructions. The Lord is giving us assurance that He is the God who fights our battle. He anoints us with the anointing of might. that gives you divine strength to face every pressure of the enemy. Especially in the midst of challenges, the Bible says, if there is anyone who is lacking wisdom, let him ask of God, and God will give him abundantly and ungrudgingly. Wisdom is knowing to do, knowing what to do when you don't know what to do. Wisdom is knowing what to do when you did not know, or when you don't know what to do. So let us always ask for wisdom, and let us repent that most of the time in the midst of major decisions we have taken the wisdom of this world, got deceived and reached the wrong path and the wrong destination. Right now, as you are praying, God is anointing each one of us with the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of might, the spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord is residing inside of each one of us. These are the 7 facets of the Holy Spirit. And through these 7 facets, we experience victory in our life. Jesus was perfect, and he was filled with extreme wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And because of this wisdom, Jesus was doing mighty works. And that is why people who were watching these mighty works began to question themselves. They were so impressed with Jesus' miracles that they wondered, from where did he get this power? What was the source of his power? Let us ask God to fill us with that kind of wisdom. Wisdom to carry out the Lord's mission, the Lord's vision for our life. We thank you, we praise you, Father. Believing in faith that your anointing has set us free. Your anointing has delivered us. Your anointing has healed us. Your anointing has blessed us. Your anointing has removed the burden of the devil and destroyed the yoke of the enemy completely. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Praise God.
So here are 12 steps by which we can plan to get victory in our life. We'll just write down these 12 and we'll study them tomorrow. Is that okay?
Yes.
You can write down these 12 points. The first one, believe the Bible. The second one, read and study the Word. Third, renew your mind with the Word. Like to see your love. God bless you. 4, honor the Word. 4, honor the word by making it the final authority. Honor the word by making it the final authority in your life. By making it the final authority in your life. Fifth one, set your mind on victory. Set your mind on victory. Sixth, obey the word. Sixth, obey the word. Seventh, understand your covenant. Understand your covenant. The Abrahamic covenant. Understand your covenant. The Abrahamic covenant. Eighth, no?
Eighth.
Use your mouth. Use your mouth as a weapon. Use your mouth as a weapon to launch. Use your mouth as a weapon to launch covenant talk. To launch covenant talk. Next one. Labor to enter into rest. Labor to enter into rest. Labor to enter into rest. Have confidence in God's love for you. Have confidence in God's love for you. Have confidence in God's love for you. How many became?
Ten.
Now tenth one.
No, tenth is finished. 11th.
No.
That was one.
That was ninth one.
Ninth one, both were together.
Okay, okay.
Okay, tenth. Walk by faith. Walk by faith, which works by love. Walk by faith, which works by love. 11th, pray. 11th, pray. And 12th, don't quit. 12th,
don't quit.
Don't quit.
Every failure in life is a prayer failure. Prayer fails.
Because when you pray, you are asking God's interference. Prayer gives you the strength to obey God's word. That's why you will find all the heroes in the Bible, they were excellent in their prayer life. So prayer will give you divine strength to face challenges in life. So if you are a person who is prayers are wrong, then everything goes wrong.
If you are failure, that means your prayer is not fruitful. I mean, you are not done the right way of praying.
You look at Daniel. How was his life? Prayerful. Look at the three friends, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego.
Yes.
Look at all the heroes in the Bible. They could experience God's supernatural power because of their relationship with God.
I have one question, right, when you say prayer, and we also, what we are studying that we have to be right with God, right? There are so many very successful people whose lives are not well.
You are checking their success from what sense?
Material sense.
Okay, even if they are successful in a lot of material sense, but what about their soul? See, the very thing, you know, when you are born again, now I know a person who has got so much of wealth that he doesn't himself know how much of wealth he got. Real?
Yeah, there are many people like that.
They really don't know how much wealth they got. Okay? But with all that wealth, that person was in depression. With all that wealth, that person had to take sleeping pills. With all that wealth, his marriage was in crisis. With all that wealth, his children were gone. Now, according to somebody who is looking at the wealth, will say, my God.
What a wonderful life, yeah.
But he would say, brother, I could not get one day of sleep. So, a time came when he made Jesus the Lord of his life, and he was not even a Christian. And God gave him, delivered him from alcohol, delivered him from sleeping drugs, and heavy means extreme heavy drugs. And then he says, today I sleep like a baby. Okay? And then he began to compare himself with his brother, okay, who is also extremely rich, richer than him. So, when he compares with his brother, he should feel depressed because he is on a lower side. Okay? Then he said, one day, he was a little sad. So the Lord said, on one side is the wealth that you got, and on the other side, you got me. Which one do you want to choose? And he said, I want to choose you because you gave me life. You gave me eternal life. So now I'm not worried about comparing with my brother. I'm more richer than my brother because I've got the Creator with me.
Praise God.
So his whole way of thinking changed.
I have one more question.
I'll tell you, brother, one thing. She might be asking the question and others might be saying, ask more. You know why? Because they all are getting blessed with the answers. Yes or no?
Yes.
And you see, they are all chupa rustam. They are all chupa rustam. They will not open their mouth. But when the answers are given, the ears are open.
And that's also clear.
The first will be the last and the last will be the first.
Okay.
If someone else asked me. So why not enjoy life anyway? God is giving us forgiveness and I can I'm still young. Okay, see somebody, a younger person whom I spoke to. Okay, you have finished all your life. Now at this age of 50, you are talking like this. I'm 53. So what a... The younger person.
This is the only lady who tells the age. Because most of the lady feels, if I tell the age, I become old very fast. That's why ladies never tell their age. And they tell people, don't ask my age. Because the moment they open their mouth and they tell their age, they get old very fast.
No, I become young. Brother.
Do you know that?
Yes, brother.
What you know?
The age.
Yeah, why? Why?
They feel that they are still young, even though...
No, because their thinking is, when I tell the age, I will become old fast.
Okay, so the person who is younger, now I am still 20, I meant to enjoy my life. And because you have gone through all that stage, now you only talk about God. When you were young, you weren't like this. Because I said, I didn't have the knowledge. So today I have got...
No, okay, you can say this. My dear friend, you are 20. When you will become old, you will come to Christ, no? He'll say yes. Or she'll say yes. But what guarantee tonight is the last night?
Then brother, how do you convince those youngsters? They say you have to go for parties, you have to do this, do that. So like
you can't convince them of anything. Only when they taste Jesus, they will let go of everything on their own. If they are doing with their willpower and with by force, it's not a conversion, it's not a change. It's temporary. But when they really, really have Jesus, they with their own choice say, I don't want it anymore. That's when the real conversion takes place. And that's why you should not tell them, don't go for party. You must introduce so much of Jesus in them that now they want to say, I don't want anything, I want Jesus.
Praise God.
And the question that you said, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. How does the person become first, last and last first?
It's a quotation from the Bible, right?
But why?
Because obeying and putting into practice the word of God.
Huh?
Obeying and putting into practice the word of God.
No. He is talking about the first becoming last in the case of John the Baptist. He said there was no prophet like John the Baptist. He is the highest.
Yes.
But even though he is the highest, now he is the least among all. You know why? Because John the Baptist got offended with Jesus. Tomorrow I'll explain. Don't give me that face. I will surely give you the answer tomorrow. Okay? I like the face that you made. It was really, really good. Means everything in you said, what is he talking? Tomorrow we will study that. Okay? Like what God wants to show us, even a person like John the Baptist, who heard the Spirit of God speak to him, this is the Messiah, who saw the glory of God, yet under pressure he could make a mistake. In other words, we all can make mistakes. And Jesus is showing us, if John the Baptist had to do something, he could have avoided the mistake. So, because he got offended with Jesus, Jesus said, even though he is on the top list, now this offense has brought him from the top position to the least position. And it was in the midst of offense that John the Baptist lost his head. So when you get offended, you are bound. There are chances that the devil can knock off your head. The devil can knock you off anywhere, because now you are under his captivity. Offense is dangerous. It opens the door for the devil to strike you anytime. Praise God.
Praise God.
Tomorrow we'll study that. And I'm giving you the trailer of tomorrow so that you come tomorrow. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Loving Father, we thank you, we praise you. Thank you, Lord, for showing us that battles are real, but much more than that, victories are more real. And you desire that all your children live a victorious life. Not a life of a beggar, but a life of a believer. Because believing is what pleases you more than anything. And Father, we thank you for this wonderful 2 days that we enjoyed your presence. You taught us so many things, gave us dictation, revelation, opened the secrets to us. Almighty God, help us to put them into practice, meditate on them, and apply them in our day-to-day life and experience the victory. And we know, Lord, that this anointing that you have blessed us, you want us to use it, because you have called us on a mission to destroy the kingdom of darkness. Anointing is given to destroy the kingdom of darkness. Yes, Father, we thank you for this powerful weapon that you have given us. And we thank you that you have forgiven us for the times when we were lazy and did not use this weapon.
Yes, God.
But now we are active and alert, like a soldier in the army going through the training, so that this training is over in 3 days. Then we exercise this, what we have learned, and put it into practice and pass the test and come back victorious with joy, saying, yes, truly, Lord Jesus, in your name, the demons are subject to us, and we see victory over victory in our lives and in the lives of others. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen.